The chronology. May 22nd, 2017, I'm told to be at this certain place to refresh, to really refresh and gain, you know, gather my resolve. And that takes place. Then I go back home. And June 4th, I'm able to have this meeting with Jesus. In this dream, I was consciously able to allow him, his presence to be with me. And this brought about what's called the New Way Practice. First saying, I have no value. And then secondly saying, I have no importance. This type of practice. I have absolutely no value. I never have, never will. And I have no importance. I'm not important enough to die. I'm not important enough to die. In fact, I have no importance, zero importance. So I don't have the importance to die. So this is the New Way practice of flattening everything. Then, on July 4th, around the date of July 4th, I have this dream where Buddha Longchenpa blocks my death. I was scheduled to die, and he blocked my death. Okay, so these events are happening, boom, boom, boom. And today, yesterday on was it July 8th, I put out this information that maybe this is something that is meant to help people who are very dharmic, trusting in the grace of God, the Holy Spirit, the Dharma, the Dharma kings, and all of that, who are wanting a boost at these times. It may be something like a very intriguing storyline to at least check in with every day and say, you know, what's going on with this storyline? This is very intriguing. What is going to happen? The Buddha Longchenpa steps in and blocks a death. And he's in this wrangling, you know, he's insisting upon it. And this young woman cashier is insisting, no, you have to go along according to the habits of this world. And so there's this wrangling going on, debate going on back and forth between the two of them. Meanwhile, my life here is in overtime, so to speak, hangs in the balance. I put that out. Now, July 9th, we're at July 9th, 2017 here. Something took place last night. And it's absolutely worth bringing this to light here. Because we want to know what's going to happen now that this has taken place. Now keep in mind, in November of 2016, I did this intensive, Longchenpa intensive, Apex Yogin intensive. And during that intensive, it was promised that certainly the Apex Array, the Manjushri, Padmasambhava, Longchenpa, Jamyang Khyentse Chokyi Lodro, Apex Array, the Bodhisattva Apex Array, at the right moment, just at the right moment, just before the sun was setting, they would show up and they would make the decisive move to help out. So I trust that this would happen. This is what's got me through the preceding months, December, January, February, March, April, May, 6 months, and then June. So I was given this tremendous sign, unequivocal sign, absolutely tremendous sign, that from birds, actually. They use birds, these huge birds. They may have been pelicans. And it was a very dramatic situation where I prayed and prayed so intense. I said, "You please show us a sign that before the sun sets, you are going to show up." And just before the sun set, they flew across right the middle of the sun. They flew across the middle of the sun by the ocean in perfect formation. and very close. It was done in such an incredibly beautiful way that it was totally unmistakable. The timing was absolutely perfect. And I said, wow, they will show up and they will do something very dramatic, very, very effective, just at the right moment. So as we go into the summer of 2017, I said, this is the crucial summer where the implosion of our psychology, our psychological implosion on this planet is taking place now. And it most certainly is. It most certainly is. It's maybe to be followed by a physical implosion. I don't know. But certainly, psychologically, this implosion is taking place to an unprecedented extent here. It's all been set up that way. And so, right on cue, Longchenpa, the implosion was so bad, I was getting herded into dying, checking out, just because that was the expectations. We worship death. The ego is a death worshiper. And this world reflects our desire to worship death as our salvation, actually. Because it seems to be the unfixing of something. Some life form gets unfixed, undone, unfixed. And so it's a backwards way of trying to establish that there was fixation in the first place, which is the mind believes it has to find a way to fixate itself to prevent its annihilation. And I've gone over and over this so many times, I will more, but we want to advance to what's happened. A sneeze tried to hit me really hard right there. And this time I just used sheer determination and it just stopped it. First of all, in the dream, I believe the sequence was, there was this old woman, aged face, very shriveled, ugly, horrible looking face, staring at me. Like she's trying to turn me to stone and say, you know, aging happens, death happens. Look at me, look at me, look at me. And I looked at the face and I took up the challenge and said, no, 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 no. This is not your true face. This is a pretense. This is 100% pretense. And as I held that thought, suddenly her face, all the aging, all traces of age faded away. And I saw the face was Sri Sri Anandamayima. And then when she saw that I had seen her, through her disguise, she burst out in laughter. Burst out in laughter. And I was like, wow. But that was just a precursor. And what came next was much more intense, actually, to my expectations, you see. So what happened next was in a dream, I was sitting here like this. I was sitting down, and out of the blue sky came this bird towards me, and it was this dove. And on the inside of the dove's wings was this iridescent rainbow like colors along the inside of each wing as it was coming down towards me like this. On the exterior of the dove, it was very nondescript. It was very like earth tones, okay? No bright colors at all, just muted earth tones on the outside. And the dove, of course, they're very slick and smooth, totally smooth, they're feathering, right? And so the bird came towards me, and I was just sitting there saying, wow, what's going to happen? And the bird then landed on my head. So I stayed calm. I said, wow, okay, bird landing on my head, wow. Bird not landing on my head, wow. Bird landing on my head, wow. Bird not landing on my head, wow. So I kept my reactions flat as well as I could. Under the circumstance, I say, what's going to happen next? I don't know. But I didn't try to do anything. I just remained still. bird landing on my head, bird not landing on my head. Then, since I stayed calm and stayed flat, the bird kind of moved around a little bit, and then I felt it like settle down on my head and grab a hold of my hair in such a way that it rooted itself there, really, and it nested on my head, and I decided it's going to make my head its nest. It's going to nest there. It's its perch. It's nested in this perch. It said, this is where I'm going to perch. And I said, wow, bird perching, nesting on my head, wow. I have a bird nesting on my head. Wow, bird nesting on my head. Wow, bird, no bird nesting on my head. Wow, bird nesting on my head. Wow, no bird nesting on my head. Wow. But then I kind of got up and I sort of was saying to people, I say, hey, look, you know, I have a bird nesting on my head. And I was kind of walking around, kind of moving around a little bit. I have a bird nesting on my head. Well, that's never happened. I've never had a dream like that. And I don't know too many people who birds fly down out of the sky and nest on their head. But this is what took place. So this is really a departure from my expectations, right? From expectations. Tremendous departure from expectations. So it's a nest on my head. It's just the earth tones. It's just the earth tones. And so this dove's head is like right above my head like this. The head of a dove there. And it's very calm. Not moving. Very calm. Quiet. But I know inside its wings, it's this gorgeous, iridescent, vivid color. But it's not showing that to the world. But I know that it has this, you see. So my nerves are kind of a bit frazzled right now, and I'm trying to, definitely a nervous strain here, and I'm keeping things very flat and low-key, because I don't know what's going to happen next, so I really need to keep it that way. And the idea is that we don't know what's going to happen next, but the Manjushri's apex array, the great Bodhisattva Buddha Manjushri, and that array of compassion, which includes Padmasambhava, Longchenpa, and Jamyang Kenji Choki Lodro, they are committed to taking all steps at this time, all compassionate steps. They've certainly focused on these times right now. They're totally aware of them. And they are going to do everything necessary to help us out. So that started out in a dramatic fashion by Longchenpa interceding. He interceded. We talk about praying to God for intercession. Well, there we go. The one mind, the Buddha mind, one mind, God, the oneness, the one mind interceded using the form, the expression of Longchenpa, interceded, blocked my death. And the next step is this bird. A bird of paradise, you might say. I had a dream about several weeks ago about this, I say this bird of paradise came and was just hovering right near me. And then it came closer, and then I said, can you go away a little further away, and went a little further away, and I realized this bird of paradise had come to me. So that was the first step of this bird. And this time, this bird now is nesting on my head. Now, what does this mean? It means this bird finds my head a suitable nest. And by my head, it means my belief system. Mind, the mind, my mind is a suitable nesting place for it. My belief system. So, I certainly ascribe this to the new way practice that I've been doing now steady every day since June 4th. It's been at least 5 weeks of this now. So, it says, this is a suitable nesting place for me. So, from this we see that this new way practice is tremendously helpful and successful. So much so that this bird will literally see you suitable and say, this looks like a nest. This feels like a nest. The bird goes with this feeling. The vibration is the right vibration for me to stay here. I'm welcome to stay here. I'm welcome to stay here. I find this a welcome roosting place, coming down from heaven, from paradise. So this is a very dramatic development already. I have to let my nerves get used to this, let them settle. They're really on edge right now, feeling a bit raw. Wow. Wow. So the key is to full stop in the wow, this situation, and make no plans at all to do anything about it. Also in the dream, there is this raucous woman who she came into to this adjacent room and shouted out through the doorway to me. I didn't see her, but she shouted out, says, "Hey, you know, what makes you special? What makes you so special?" Like she wanted to know how I felt about myself. What quality makes me special? And I replied to her, I says, "I'm nothing. I'm nothing at all." Then she burst out laughing. She was laughing, raucously laughing. Didn't expect that. You see, didn't expect that. It's this idea of the world, everyone's promoting specialness. You know, what makes you special, special, special? And I'd say, and I said, I have no value at all. I'm not important enough to be special. So that is my attitude. I'm not. What's that? Oh, my phone just died. Okay, I'm gonna have to grab something to charge it. Phones can die, but I can't. It's okay if the phone dies. So I don't. Specialness as well, no specialness as well. Specialness as well, no specialness as well. Now specialness means that you fix it. We believe it's our attempt to fixate somehow. Fixate the mind. That's the drive. And then once we fixate the mind, we then undo that fixation to try and remind the mind that it has the power to fixate, because the mind seems, even when it seems to fixate, it doesn't seem sure of itself. Of course, why? Because it's not fixating anything at all. So the push in this world now is make sure everyone feels special, whereas the new way, coming from Jesus and the Dharma Kings, the new way, from the grace of God, really, is to work on flattening out all sense of specialness. flattening out. Now, does that mean that there's nothing intriguing to follow? No. The fact that there's a very intriguing storyline to follow, the grace of God storyline, is very intriguing. It's how do we get free of this delusion of specialness, right? Which is really the delusion of fixation, which is really how it plays out here, is a delusion of death. Aging, death. You know, we have something special, in other words, something, a form that's fixated, the life, and then the life starts aging, and then it dies, meaning it's lost its specialness, it's been unfixated. So if the mind has the power to unfixate, that must mean it has the power to fixate. Who fixated it in the first place, right? And so death, aging and death is a way, is to try to shock the mind into remembering, into accepting and seeing its power of fixation. It doesn't know. It says, I'm not sure. I don't know how I'm doing this, really. Well, it's not doing it, is the answer. So we can play with aging and death as much as we want. It will never establish the mind in knowing how to fixate. The mind cannot fixate. So it's all, again, useless, aimlessness. This aging and dying is totally aimless. Ultimately, producing these forms is aimless. These so-called forms is aimless. But that is more akin to creativity than aging and death. Aging and death is really far afield, you know, from reality, where everything is sparklingly fresh and new each instant, and endlessly creative, with no trace of aging or death at all. Now, it's all done with essence, not form. There's no fixation of the mind. But certainly, in our way of relinquishing our fear, you would say that relinquishing aging and death would be the first crucial step. So inside of the bird's wings was iridescent and sparkling, the colors. So fresh and vivid and clear. And yet it's taken on the earth tones of as it sits on my head, so as to not attract attention, undue attention here. So this is low key, very low key here. For those who have the ears to hear it and see it. It's not externally flashy, the situation. It's not externally flashy. But inwardly, it is absolutely, vividly amazing. Let me grab that. I'm surprised. I need that charger. So let your nerves settle down and wow the information that you have just heard. And you can say, you know, hearing this information, wow. Not hearing this information, wow. One reaction for everything, same reaction. Hearing this information, wow. Not hearing this information, wow. So doing the wow is very important. So this very intriguing play that is going on here is nerve-wracking for me, that is for sure. I don't know what's going to happen. I didn't expect that dream to take place. So this bird landed on my head. I was just like, what? Okay, a bird just, you know, I tried to stay in the wow practice. Let me see. Battery too low, powering off. Well, it should be charging. Okay. Uh-oh. Battery too low, powering off. Huh. Weird. Maybe the last showing electronics are going to be powered off at some point. No. It will not stay on. Interesting. Oh well. I might have to inform people that the battery is off. My phone is off. It shows a... I don't know. It shows a full battery. It's not charging. Oh well. There it goes. Now it's starting to charge. Okay. That'll get it going in a little while. I'll be able to turn it on. But with me, my battery's not going off. Although this nervousness can make it seem, you know, you get tired with this distress. Okay, bird is on my head. That's the new way. It's the new chapter. So in this new chapter, it's like we don't know what's going to happen. It's different than the old expectations. So the old expectations don't work at this point. The old expectations don't work. Removable disc, I don't know. They don't. And so we mustn't cling to the old expectations. We must discipline ourselves that there's a new set of expectations arising here. A new set of spiritual expectations. And in order to benefit from them, we really have to be disciplined. And we really have to practice. Those who do practice will find that they're able to benefit from these new expectations and allow situations to occur that are extremely beneficial for everyone. Okay? For Dharmic culture, which really is beneficial for everyone in the long run. So they're able to allow this to happen. So I was able to allow that bird to first perch on my head. I didn't, like when it was coming towards me, I didn't duck out of the way and say, what's going on? I just stayed calm, didn't move. And then when it perched on my head, I didn't panic. And then when it stayed on my head, I'm a little bit shocked for sure. But I'm saying, okay. Let's go with it. This is a new expectation. Bird on the head. New expectation here. Great. Wow. Wow. I don't say great. Let's not say great. Just say wow. Not good, not bad, not yes, not no. Just wow. Just wow. Having all sorts of reactions from this computer, but it's still working somehow. Yeah, it's definitely a big wow. So I'm not putting any value on this, you see. I'm refusing to value it. It's very important. Part of the new way is to not refuse to put any value on anything. That doesn't mean we're not aware of something, but we're not putting any value on it. It's just, except wow. One value for everything is just wow. So I put the value on wow. I know what I am. I'm wow. The bird nesting on my head is wow. My death being blocked by Buddha Long Champa, wow. So one definition for everything, one value for everything, one plan for everything, one reaction for everything, which is wow. And when you commit to this, you just feel this relief. Oh, you say, oh, I can do this. Yeah. Not only can I do this, this is what's expected of us in the new chapter, the new way. This is how you go with it, flow with it. This is how you flow with the new way, is putting this one value, definition, reaction, structure, concept, hope, everything. Just one wow for all of that. It's all just wow. The same, the same, the same, the same, the same. So I don't have specialness, I have sameness. Wow. I have this perfect sameness. Wow. Now this bird is very still. It became utterly still. So I have this utterly still bird, this dove resting on my head right now. Wow. Do I know what's going to come next? No, I don't. Wow is going to come next. So there you go. This blocks the panic. So I know. Wow. What's next? Wow is next. Whew. I just felt a flash of relief there. Wow is next. Because I was wondering what's going to happen next. No, I know what's going to happen next. Wow is going to happen next. So you can employ this in your own unfoldment here of the new chapter, the new way, the new expectations, really. We're dropping all expectations and just putting one expectation, which is wow. So in dropping all expectations, it seems like a death, right? But Longchenpa steps in and says, no, 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 no. It's the wow. We have the wow. It's a new set of expectations here. This is not death-based, okay? We're not going to use death as an expectation. And I've tried to never do that in my life. I've never tried to use death as an expectation in my life. I always expected my quote-unquote death would not follow according to expectations. Even to the point of there not even being what we would say a death. Now, many Tibetans have had their quote-unquote deaths have not followed according to our expectations at all in the world. And in fact, some of them would say, okay, I'm going to dissolve this nirmanakaya appearance, the physical body. I'm going to function in the sambhogakaya and dharmakaya more right now. So I'm going to dissolve it. And they would sit in meditation. And the breath would stop, pulse would stop, and they would still be there in meditation. And perhaps a tent would be put over them. And all these rainbow lights and huge manifestations in the sky around the area would take place for perhaps weeks. And at the end of this process, their body would dissolve away completely, no trace of it left, or just fingernails and hair, or there'd be a very little tiny small body left. And this would be saying the achieving the rainbow body. Or some would just turn directly into light. Their body would just dissolve into light like Padmasambhava. So they have very different expectations of what we call death. And it's not really a death. It's just an appearance shift, a frame of reference shift. It's a play. The nirmanakaya appears for a while, and then it disappears for a while. So I always knew I'm not going to follow the traditional pattern of death, the expectations. We're going to do a new way. We're going to do a new way here. We don't need to follow the old patterns of implosion, right? We don't need to. The old patterns of aging and death was based on trying to shock the mind into realizing that it had fixated in the first place. And this has never worked and never will work. So we can just look at death and aging and say, you know, it didn't work. That's one way of looking at it in retrospect. I say, it didn't work at all. And there's no way to shock the mind into realizing something that it never did. Remembering how it did what it never did and what it never can do. Obviously, there's no way to do that. So we can just look back on death and say, well, you know, of course it didn't work. It had no possibility that it worked. No possibility that it could ever work. So all our creativity and pretending of aging and death, it's all a pretense. It was just, you know, a great drama that didn't work. And it had no possibility of ever working from the very beginning. So there's no point in this death aging thing where it ever went wrong. Okay, this has to be really, you have to really hear this. There was no point where it suddenly got off track and went wrong at all. From the very beginning, there was no possibility that it could ever work. The ego is trying to trace back, well, where did it go wrong? You know, and go back to that point. And say, okay, fix what went wrong. There's nothing to fix at all. There's nothing to fix about aging and death at all. It never had any possibility of working. It's always been a zero-sum game from the very beginning. I started to think about the future, and I started to panic there. So, I have to go back to this one, that the future is wow. The future is wow. Because I'm extrapolating from this moment into the future. But that doesn't leave the next moment open for some other miracle, you know, some other wonderful unfoldment to take place. So we have to trust in the process here, quote-unquote process, the unfoldment of compassion of God, the compassion of the one mind, the compassion of the oneness without a second, everything, the heart of everything. So when something tremendous takes place, we have to do not plan our daydream about the future of how are things going to be now. We know how things are going to be for us. They're going to be wow for us, no doubt about it. Wow, that's it. I'm going to have this very comfortable, calm wow. I'm very comfortable with that. Do not let anything else as an outcome or reaction or definition arise. It's wow. I know how it's going to be. Wow. I know what's going to take place. It will be wow. I know all events will be wow. All situations are already wow. It's already a done deal. So I know exactly how all of the future will unfold, and I know that right now, which is wow. So really the future is wow right now. I could just stay in this, the now of wow. The wow of wow, we would say. And that's how everything is. Perpetually. So I try to calm down this bird on the head thing by saying, well, bird on the head is wow. And if the bird flying away from my head is wow. These two absolutes of what could happen, it could either stay or it could leave. So bird staying on my head, wow. Bird leaving my head, also wow. And see, that calms down the future expectations and fears. Bird staying on my head is wow. Bird leaving my head, wow. Longchenpa blocking my death, wow. Longchenpa not blocking my death, wow. This is learning to block panic, right? Leading to frame of reference shift. That's the most shocking of all. So keep in mind, the more we practice, the more we practice blocking panic in these little situations, even though they're very significant for us at this point, the better we get at that, the more, and you have to put yourself through the fire. You can't do it just intellectually. You have to actually experience these things that are quite shocking, very shocking, and then block the panic of this. And ultimately, this will enable then a frame of reference shift. And we need not try and think about that. It will happen. It will automatically happen. And then we'll be able to block the panic of that. We'll say frame of reference shift, wow. Frame of reference shift disappearing, wow. Frame of reference shift appearing, wow. Frame of reference shift disappearing, wow. Now, I've had the frame of reference shift happen for me quite a few times now. But I try not to, I don't want to define them, because our mind will then try to engage in a future with that definition in it, you see? And that's the danger. Then you open yourself up to panic. Because any time you have a definition other than something that's so abstract you can't even work with it, like wow. The ego will then start working with that definition to try and structure a future. So I don't want to describe or explain what I saw in the frame of reference shift, okay? Just have faith that it's wow, okay? It's better than expected. Frame of reference shift, better than expected, wow. The grace of God is already shining upon me as promised, and it's better than expected. Wow. This is also part of the New Way practice that gets us ready for a total frame of reference shift. Our frame of reference shifts when we're able to handle, block the panic of that. So this is what the New Way is all about, is ultimately frame of reference shift, ultimately. But about that, we cannot describe it, we cannot express it, we cannot explain it. We won't do it. We won't do it, okay? We won't do that. So this requires a great deal of faith, doesn't it? To get into descriptions and explanations of it is to really block yourself, very much so, from getting that. So we really, really want to have that frame of reference shift, so much so we're willing to not even try and describe it and work at it intellectually as some sort of goal to reach. Give up chasing after results and goals. Just have faith in this practice. Blocking panic is absolutely essential, and we get better and better at it by putting ourselves through the fire of these miraculous experiences that we're having. Longchenpa blocking my death. Wow. You see, that's very, very amazing. And then the bird of paradise now landing in, nesting on my head, roosting on my head. Wow. Okay, but it's just that. The future is wow. Frame of reference shift, wow. No frame of reference shift, wow. How is the frame of reference shift going to be? It's going to be wow. What takes place? Wow takes place. What's the definition of it? Definition is wow. Description of it is wow. See, this is the new way practice. So we're aiming at what really works. Okay, we're now down to the nitty-gritty of what works. We're not fooling around anymore. When you let go of your demand that you have a description that you're aiming towards some goal that can be described and imagined and stuff, that means you've gotten truly serious, truly earnest. And it will truly work. You're doing what will actually work now. Before, we were trying to please both the ego and the Holy Spirit, okay? And that's what has caused the past chapter to be the way that it has been, is we were still caught up in trying to please both the ego and the Holy Spirit. In other words, trying to have both a false premise be true and a true premise be true, okay? Which is just absurdity, because you can't have a false premise unless the true premise is already true, you see? So it's a false premise is dependent on truth. So you cannot then elevate a false premise to be the same as the original premise. You see, it's not possible. That's absurdity. The only way we know that a false premise is false is because truth is already true. Already true. It was already true before we engaged in a false premise. Otherwise, we could never have even engaged in a false premise in the first place. So it absolutely shows priority, when priority is to God, the prime creator. Priorness, already-ness. So the grace of God is already shining upon me as promised, and is greater than expected. It's greater than expected. Not as hot today. Still very calm. Very, very calm. So we're at 100 and 101. I don't know what today's going to be. Probably not so bad. Maybe, low 90s or something. So the frame of reference shift is wow. What you experience there is wow. My experience is wow. My reaction is wow. My explanation is wow. What did it arise out of? It came out of wow. What caused it? Wow caused it. Wow caused it. Wow is defining it. Wow is the value of it. Wow is the experiencing of it. Wow is the reaction to it. Wow is how I feel about it. It's absolutely essential to have this ready to go as a great habit. And our expectations expect us to do this, you see. We have to get to the point where our expectations expect us to use the wow in any frame of reference shift. So then we'll just automatically do it then, because that's what we expect to do. There won't be any struggle to do it. And then in doing this then, we'll block panic from taking place. And therefore we will stay with this frame of reference. We will keep abiding with it. We will not pivot our attention off of it. And then we'll get used to it. And as we get used to it, then we'll relax into it more and more and more. So wow is this bridge, okay? We're not always going to stay on the bridge, okay? But we're making sure that we have this extremely sturdy bridge, okay? Have to do that. Do it that way. You don't luck into it. You don't luck into it. Our expectations have to expect us to have a very shocking frame of reference shift and to wow it when this takes place. So we'll be doing exactly what we expect to be doing, and then we won't panic. You see, the whole key to panic is that you have to, blocking panic is you have to feel like you're doing exactly what you expect to be doing. That's why in wartime they train the soldiers to just carry out their orders. So as long as, and if you're carrying out orders, you're taught that you're doing the right thing and everything's fine. So there can be, there's bombs bursting, just, you know, all hell's breaking loose. But if the soldiers feel, well, I'm following the orders that I have from my superiors, I'm following orders, I'm fine. I'm doing what I'm supposed to be doing. No panic. So they don't panic. They don't panic. You might wonder, how in the world can they be on the battlefield? It's called basic training. It's all the training that they undergo, psychological training. It's very intense psychological training, knowing that they'll be put in situations that would drive normal psyche to total panic, and then that would mount to defeat. The whole chain of command, the whole strategy, everything would break down. So they're trained to feel totally wrong if they don't follow orders, and totally right if they do. So when they get an order, as long as they keep that order in mind, they say, I'm fine. There's no panic taking place. Everything is fine. I'm doing what I'm supposed to be doing. So you see these soldiers, how could they be so calm in the situations they're in? Because they say, well, I am exactly where I was told to be. Okay, I was ordered to be here on my post. So I'm here. Check. Everything's fine. I was told to have my rifle ready and loaded. Check. I did that. Checked it. So that's fine. I was told to stay here until further orders. Check. I'm doing that. That's fine. I was told that if I do this, that everything will be fine and the superiors will know what to tell me next. So check. Doing that. That's fine. I've been told to engage the enemy if that comes about. Check. Ready for that. Check. And so, you know, and they'd say, and I was told to just relax and hang out there, you know. So I'm doing that, having a smoke, drinking some coffee, and staying awake, check. So I'm just like, hey, everything's fine. Everything's going the way it's supposed to be. I'm doing exactly what I'm expected to do. No trouble. Now, this isn't, you know, the ideal analogy, right? Because if you might want to get off the battlefield, right? But this is like the opposite. But what I'm saying is, I'm bringing up an extreme situation of extreme panic where you want to leave, like, oh my gosh, you know, this, you know, all chaos is about to break loose or something, as far as my expectations are concerned, right? Because in battle, what one of the key things is that you try to throw the expectations of your opponent completely out of whack, so they panic. Once they panic, they can't really defend themselves properly. So that's why they have these sneak attacks, sneak so you don't expect it. But if you expect what they're going to do, you stay calm, relaxed, you know, you feel prepared and all this. It's a different story. Well, the frame of reference shift is not onto battle, but freedom from battle. Freedom from the unexpected. But temporarily, that's unexpected, you see. It's very unexpected. To what we see in the frame of reference shift, it's so wonderful, it's so wowish, that we realize I'll never again ever be shocked or need to panic at all. You know, you realize, oh my gosh. But that is extremely unexpected. And even if we intellectually try to describe it for ourselves and try to imagine it, it's still extremely unexpected. So merely role-playing, trying to imagine it, that's not enough. This is what I've seen. Going about it in a superficial way is you can get glimpses of it, but that's it. You cannot stay with it. You will not be able to stay with it. That's from the long history of my life. That's what I've experienced. I'm so frustrated. I get glimpses, and I can't stay with it. So I had to dig deeper and said, wow, we have to find a bridge that will actually work so we're able to actually stay with this. So that's what I've done. So those of you watching this, these videos are probably in the same boat. You've had glimpses, but they fade away. You can't seem to stay with it. And it's very, very frustrating. But the new way is designed to put that to rest once and for all. So really, since a hummingbird, right here. It's right here. It's right here. Hello, hummingbird. Yeah. It's just checking me out. Iridescent. Hummingbird has iridescent colors, right? There you go. Iridescent red. Ruby hummingbird. Ruby-throated hummingbird. With a dowdy exterior, right? But the beautiful humming and that soft of its sound of its wings. Just came right up checking me out. Thank you, hummingbird. As if to say, yeah, you're doing fine. You're doing fine. Wow. Why were there so many miracles in the past? People expected them. They didn't run too contrary to their expectations. They really expected it. This is the way everything works. These days, why are there so few? Nobody expects them anymore, you see. So our expectations are extraordinarily powerful in terms of shaping our experiencing. And if we think that we can step out of the realm of our expectations and remain totally outside the realm of our expectations for long, well, you know through your own experience how that goes, right? It's futility, isn't it? And very frustrating futility. Now, I tried. In 1978, I made the great effort. I said, I'm going to step totally outside the realm of all my expectations and all the whole world's expectations and be truly, you know, enlightened. And so I made the move to do it. And then this was when the huge anxiety hit me, the huge dread. And then I realized, oh, okay, so that's how it goes. That's what everyone's trouble is here. I wanted to really experience what is the trouble here and feel it, and felt just how intense the fear was, absolutely intense. And then then I asked for help. The Holy Spirit showed up and said, okay. The Holy Spirit says, look, I got this. Don't worry. We will just work at this, and we will resolve this situation. No doubt about it. But it'll take a steady determination. I said, well, I'm good at that, so I can do that. The Holy Spirit said, your part is just steady determination working at it. I'll do the rest. And I said, well, okay, deal, you know, done deal. I can do the steady determination part. So I was very confident about that from previous lives. It's been a lot of steady determination, that's for sure. But I've been doing it. I said I would. So there you go. So the notion of stepping outside all expectations and staying there based on luck is absurdity. There's a dynamic at work. Fear. Yeah. Just to say there's no such thing as fear. Well, step outside all expectations and remain there without first reconditioning your expectations to expect this. And you will find out that at some point, fear is going to arise. Now, there have been some who have tried this, okay, without doing this sort of reconditioning their expectations. And they had enough people supporting them and you know, saying, yeah, you're great. They were able to stay out for a little while. Sometimes there are these people who do this for a while but then demand that everybody worship them. It'd be like a booster section of worshiping them to keep them there, but it doesn't work. They come out of it, and then from that point on it's just this sort of slide into despondency. You know, just things don't seem to be going right anymore. That's happened. But you see, having been through that whole era of those trying to do it that way, I realized it doesn't work. It ends badly. It ends badly. You see so many gurus, right? I'm not going to name their names, but there's been so many. That was the pattern. That was the old pattern, actually. It was an old pattern. It's hard to find any guru that it didn't happen to, except the Dharma kings, like Ramaharshi. He never slid out of it. Nandamayama never slid out of it, being an avatara. So the old pattern was that you can stay there, kind of stay there, and if everybody is helping you stay there, you can stay there. But in the back of your mind, there's still this feeling like, I'm not really sure, you know, if I can really stay here in this new frame of reference. And they ultimately demand more and more and more and more from their devotees. More and more, you know, absolute obedience, slavish obedience. They become dictatorial, very unstable and dictatorial, because their own confidence they can stay in this new frame of reference is getting shaken more and more and more, because they don't really know how to stay in it. They think the way is, again, to culturally have all the support. But when the culture support's not there, they can't do it. So that's why we have so few of those types at this point, because there's almost no cultural support anymore. But that was a very unstable and ultimately disappointing situation. And, you know, some gurus even admitted, at least one did, that, you know, he had fallen back down. He was kind of forced to admit it. It wasn't easy, but at least he did admit it. And he said, I've got to get right. But what he really did was go back to try to find some better cultural support for himself, from what I understand. So he didn't really get it. He didn't really get it. And people are a little bit nervous, thinking that you know, in other words, he went back to India. He went to India trying to find, you know, there's more cultural support of the guru. Of like, yes, guru, you know, you're perfect, you're wonderful, yes, guru. Sort of a codependency thing there. That's not it. That's not it. That's still egoic. That's still trying to please both the ego and the Holy Spirit. So he was an American in America. He went bad. He was on this big guru trip. He obviously, it went all wrong. And it became so obvious to everyone, he had to finally admit, yeah, it's gone wrong. You know, I've gone back into ego patterns. And which was true. And then he disappeared for a while. And apparently he's been hanging out in India, where you get more of this cultural support. Okay. So where I am here, I have no cultural support. Zero. Family, relatives, also, they don't even have any clue what I'm doing. They would be completely unsupportive of it. Extremely sabotaging of it. And where I live, there's no cultural support, Silicon Valley. So I could not rely on cultural support at all. So I've had to rely on right practice. And that's all, what Dharma really is right practice. Skillful, wise, right practice, informed by the grace of God. It does not rely on a charismatic relationship with followers, okay? That's the old way. We're into the new way here. We're not relying on a charismatic situation with all these followers. And it's a dangerous situation. Longchenpa told me, lay low. You do not want to get into such a dynamic, because we're into this very new way where we know what actually works now. And it's not a charismatic personality being followed by extraordinary devotees who believe in them so much that seems to support a frame of reference shift for a while. Because at the root of that, it's still trying to please both the ego and the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit has the way to really resolve this, okay? Truly resolve it. And we have to take that new way. That way is the new way, that there's a way to truly resolve this, which is the wow practice, singularity practice. Ramana truly resolved this. No doubt about it. And Nisargadatta Maharaj truly resolved it. No doubt about it. They use singularity practice. Okay, so they were showing us. Ramana was saying, this is the way for these times. And he introduced it. Ramana really introduced he's the foundation of this new way, really, because he got the ball rolling, and he said, this is what you need to focus on now as you're going forward. This is what you really need to focus on as you're going forward at these times. So he was a precursor, laying the foundation for us. And I said, it will work. Even in these times, it will work. Trust me, this singularity practice will work. You're going to go into this very dark period, dharmically dark period, and you're going to feel like, wow, I can't do it. He says, but there absolutely is a way to do it. And he knew that there would be these gurus who would rise and then collapse. And of course, that just strengthens our belief in unfixation, which strengthens our belief in fixation. When you have all these gurus imploding, that just strengthens our delusion, actually. So he knew that would happen. So he said this, he said, focus on singularity practice. He was relentless about that. He just used the form. He said, I used the form, who am I? Because that's the form that those who came to me felt most comfortable with. But what he's saying is singularity practice. The Nisargadatta Maharaj, the same. I am. He just used I am. Which is very similar to wow. He said, all situations, I just focused on the feeling I am. Very abstract feeling, right? No gripping or dependency on anything, just I am. So here, we've reduced it to even more abstract, but it's very similar. You got your Ramana, Nisargadatta Maharaj, and now this wow practice here. So who am I is a little more complex singularity, slightly more. That's what people were ready for at that point. The Nisargadatta, which is he was more recent, brought in just I am. And now we're bringing in just wow, just wow. So those of you who have been working with this over the years, however long you've been working at it, if you can look in hindsight, there's absolutely a progression here. Now, I was aware of Rama Maharshi at a very young age. My dad was very big into Rama Maharshi when I was born. He was into that Razor's Edge, Somerset Maugham, I believe. He was into that whole scene. That they were very aware of Rama Maharshi. So I was aware of Rama Maharshi from the get-go. So you could really even say, 60 years of that. And then he came to me in about the year 2000 and told me to stick with what I'm doing. He said, stick with this. But the way you're going about it, I said, yeah, absolutely, I want you to stick with that. That is going to be super helpful. That's part of his influence, actually, his great help. He was, a Dharma king, Rama Maharshi. And Dharma kings have tremendously helpful influence here. So we went through this period from Rama Maharshi, when I think he passed away in 1950, dropped the body in 1950. And of course he said, I never was the body. The death of the body has nothing to do with me at all. Same with Nisargadatta Maharaj. He says, you're saying I'm dying. He says, a body is dying, but body has absolutely nothing to do with what I am. So I don't see anything dying at all, really, actually. And ultimately, nothing does die. Nothing becomes unfixated because nothing is fixated, actually. So then we have Nisargadatta Maharaj. I think, I don't know, when was I Am That published? I don't know. I don't have it with me. But it seems like it was like maybe early 80s or something. I should check on that. I think it was like 1982 or something like that. I don't know. But it was very popular. And then... Punjaji was a disciple of Rama Maharshi. There's many who are beyond practicing the inquiry, who am I, or I am. A lot of non-dual situations arising. A lot of focus on that. Along with these charismatic gurus arising and imploding. They're really trying to implode the singularity practice, actually. It was really the ego. The attempt to mix truth and lies is the ego. The attempt to please both the ego and the Holy Spirit is all ego. It's all ego. So they may seem to be pleasing, you know, the great Holy Spirit with all the pomp and all the stuff they do, but they're also trying to please the ego, and that's actually all ego. So really, it was an attempt to implode the momentum that Ram Maharshi had really, the great turn of the wheel of Dharma that Ram Maharshi had applied, the great momentum. It was an attempt to implode that, these charismatic gurus. And it almost succeeded, actually. It almost succeeded. Caused me a lot of trouble, that is for sure. But it didn't succeed. So that's part of the previous chapter. But it's helpful to see, you know, why, what this new chapter is about. We're in a really, really new chapter now. So celebrate, you know, like, wow, yeah. We're in this wonderful new chapter, actually, where we literally now have the means. We're aware of the means, the super streamlined means. The only difference is it's a little bit more streamlined now than ever before, which is needed right now because we've been through the trauma of the previous chapter, and we're saying, wow, maybe this I am, who am I doesn't work, or I am doesn't work. We had so much troubles with these charismatic gurus and the implosion of them. We got sort of so many doubts and everything. But this wow is super streamlined, because that's what I've been working on. I wanted to super streamline it. And we've been able to get the help of the Dharma kings, all of them, especially the Tibetans, which is super, 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 super auspicious and helpful. I mean, they're like business people, and their business is liberation from samsara. Okay, that's it. So you want a business mentality like that at this point. You absolutely do. They're not into the charismatic guru thing, believe me. Longchenpa, no. He presented himself in the most casual of ways. You know, he's just, you know, I'm just a down-to-earth businessman mentality. I'm just here all business. And not a trace of anything else. I say, wow, I like that attitude. I love that attitude. And they are so grounded in that that we cannot even understand it. I mean, I don't even hardly try to understand it, you know. Listen. Okay. We're not going to struggle with trying to understand how grounded they are in that. But it's just truly phenomenal. It's truly phenomenal. And we should never underestimate it. The way that they trained themselves was so disciplined and so earnest and so culturally supported but with great humility, such great humility. And you know, they just set up, they're so grounded in, it's just all business here, you know. There's no glamour to it. There's no glamour there. They don't have a glamour complex, a guru glamour complex. They do not have it. Sri Sri Anandamayi Maha did not have it either. The Dharma kings do not have a spiritual ego glamour complex at all, and you can feel that. Neither does the Holy Spirit. Now, we're all prone to that to greater or lesser extent here, so it's very helpful to be grounded in none of that, so that bird that's on my head here is externally just earth tones, no glamour to it at all. But it's showing us internally, it says it's within, it's this gorgeous glory, it's this glory, it's this glory. I'm here to reveal the inner glory to you. I'm here to reveal the inner glory to you. So we are in this wonderful new chapter, and the more we get used to this new chapter, the more we leave the old one behind. The old one was of course very problematic, based on our expectations, causing us to try and please both the ego and the Holy Spirit. And our terrible struggles in trying to do that. So it was a very traumatic chapter, actually, as we tried to get free. Of suffering, all suffering, all instability, and tried to recognize nothing ever happened, and that we tried to recognize that we never have not been awake. No one's never not been awake. No one has ever not been awake. Everything has always been perfect. When we tried to realize that, we had this struggle with our expectations to the extent that we tried to please the ego too. And this brought about, tremendous inner conflict within us. So I had to live through all of that and experience all of it. And it was terrible indeed. Extremely frustrating indeed. But we have this new chapter now where this is just, not part of the scene at all. And the great turn of the Dharma wheel that has enabled us to get into this new chapter, it came from the Dharma kings. It came from Ramaharshi. And it came from Sri Sri Anandamaya Maha. It came from Jamyan Kenshi Choki Lodro. It came from Longchenpa. It came from Padmasambhava Manjushri. And it came from Jesus Christ. With A Course in Miracles. These tremendous turns of the wheel of Dharma is what has enabled us to get to this new chapter. Without that help, we would not have gotten to this new chapter. There's just no way. The ego's attempt to implode was very, 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 very all in, clever, really. Played hardball. The ego really played hardball this time around. It always plays hardball, but this time it was like no holds barred. In wrestling, the entertainment we call wrestling, they say this is a no-holds-barred match, meaning anything goes. And I guess everyone's interest, right? Well, we've just been through this no-holds-barred chapter where the ego really didn't play fair at all, did it? No, it didn't. And now it's whining, says, oh, it's not fair that I didn't succeed. Yeah. Or say, if I just hadn't have played fair, I would have succeeded. Well, believe me, ego, you didn't play fair. So it means that, no, the success is not possible. It really, really, ego really pulled out all the stops in unfairness. We can honor that. We can honor. Said, yeah. We can leave that chapter behind by saying you really did max out the unfairness. We really tried so much, so well, and it didn't work. And now we can see that, you know, doing the impossible never does work out, does it? And what strategy, what working out, what outworking can there be to doing the impossible? How can there be any satisfactory outworking of that? It always feels like an unfair outworking to us, right? Well, of course it's unfair. We're being unfair to ourselves, asking ourselves to do the impossible. So in order to feel the absence of unfairness, we have to give up trying to do the impossible. There's no other way. So we definitely try to find some other way other than giving up the attempt to do the impossible, which is to change reality. And we did our very best at that. So we need to honor. We were very creative. We really tried. But now we realize the only way is to really give up trying to do the impossible. Which means we have to look at the premise of hallucination and what's actually true, the root premise. And when we do that, frame of reference shift occurs. And when we have to block panic. So pragmatically, we can look at the root premise, which I've done many times, but the shock arises. So, oh my gosh, but I'm not quite, you know, I don't expect, you know, to succeed so perfectly and so totally. You know, when we really look at the root premise, total success is ours. Total success is ours. Total absence of failure. And we're so habituated to failing to reach our goals, which has been trying to do the impossible. All we experience is failure, right? So we so totally expect failure. To see a complete absence of failure forevermore is so shocking. What we do is we say, well, I'll allow an absence of failure for a little while, but then I'll have to have failure later on. And this is these charismatic gurus. They seem to have got it, but then later on, suddenly failure crops up. So where did that come from? And then it, you know, goes really bad. Because they call it making a deal with the devil, and we don't want to do that anymore. Because our expectations are that we expect failure, that we're willing to see a lack of failure for a little while, but not forever. So we take out that eternalness, that foreverness out of our experiencing, and that's not genuine realization. It's not genuine. It's fake. It's fake realization. To say, I will agree to realization for a while, but then I will also agree. I'll agree to an absence of failure for a while, but that's predicated on then going back to failure later on. That's the ego. That's the ego. That's not genuine realization. So we saying, no, we have to frame a reference shift. It has to be, you know, forever. Forever. So the ego says, I'll be without failure for a while just to please the Holy Spirit. But then we're going back to like a recation. But then we're going to get back to trying to, you know, full-on implosion here. Even more implosion. So it's more like a vacation sort of thing. It's a deal sort of thing. But that's never really the grace of God. It's never, that's the ego putting on a pretending that it's enlightened, actually. That it's in enlightenment. But that always goes wrong later on. The failure comes roaring back, right? And that was all planned that way. It was planned. So we're done with that. This new chapter is absolutely over that. Done with it. We're focused on it's forevermore. And the way we do that is block the shock of forevermore by wow. So how is it going to work out? It's going to work out wow. How long is it going to last? Wow is how long it's going to last. So we keep it abstract, very abstract, because we're aware of the extreme difficulty of this forevermoreness, okay? So we neither assert nor deny this issue, one way or the other. We say it's going to be wow. How long does it last? It's going to last for wow. What's here now? Wow is here now. How long is it lasting? It's lasting for wow. So we do not allow ourselves to fall into this trap. By keeping yourself low, we're not coming out as a charismatic guru, okay, who's enlightened. We are a novice in the wow practice in this new chapter. So to come out as a guru, as enlightened, you have to assert this is forevermore. And like you said, it's not a problem. It's absolutely easy. No doubt about it. That, you see, is our pride, our downfall. We're not accounting for our expectations. So we're not going to assert it's one way or the other, actually. We're not even asserting that we're realized or a guru. We're just wow. What I am is wow. That's it. Wow is wow. Is wow is always wow. Wow is always wow. We can assert that. I am wow, and wow is always wow. So the Tibetans are very aware of this, and the humility that they have built into their dharma. How important that is. Jamyang Kenshi Choki Lodro, you know, would never say that he's enlightened or anything like that. Everybody knew he was. But he said, no, I'm just this wretched ego, you know, not worthy of even any notice whatsoever. This is one of their techniques they use. I don't know anything. Because they experience, through long experience, they realize if you get too high hat, the ego will try to bait you into saying that, you know, you're God, that you have the forever thing nailed. I say, come on, the ego, so just do that, and everything will be solved. You know, I'll admit that I've defeated and all this. That's a trap. Because as soon as you start getting into that, these old expectations, deep lying expectations can arise, and that'll trip you up. So we realize that these expectations, we've expected total failure for so long, for eons and eons of moments, that we cannot assert, we do not want to assert while we're still here in this world that we're free of those, totally free of those. And so the Tibetans, they understand that, and so they guard against that. So we do put the Dharma Kings up there for now, because we're novice, pragmatic novices here. And they're helping us stay grounded in humility. Now, we can have the frame of reference shift, absolutely. But we are not going to assert that we're a Dharma King out of this frame of reference, okay? Longchenpa said, settle on being a Dharma Prince. This is what his approach was to me. He says, yeah, you... He says, in my eyes, you're a Dharma Prince. Okay, so get used to seeing yourself that way. Dharma Prince is someone who does have the frame of reference shift, but remains lowly in terms of this foreverness. They're not going to go there. They're not going to go there. Okay. Refuse to go there. I'm wow, and I'm always wow. Wow is always wow. Wow is always wow. I am wow. Everything is wow. There's only wow. Wow is always wow. The problem is these sort of type of devotees who are of the ego also, who want to build you up to someone to worship, because they think that this will protect them from annihilation. They're special. And that the implosion of you will be the grace, the sacrifice that will protect them. You know, Christianity has a lot of that tendency running through them, don't they? Because it gets us all, right? That the sacrifice of Jesus, the implosion of Jesus, because they accepted it, that makes them special, which means when mind may have to let go of this hallucination, that those who are special will actually... It will continue somehow, and the others will implode into nothingness. So the new creation requires a sacrifice of something in order for it to become real. This is how the ego thinks, how the false logic thinks. So they're desperate to be special. So they want to set up this feeling of specialness. But that's an egoic feeling. And that only comes from these charismatic gurus who have agreed to appear, pretend to be free of failure for a while, and then implode back into failure later on. And then sacrifice, in other words, to go the sacrificial route. And then this gives the devotees a feeling of specialness, which they think will protect them, like the blood of the land, to protect them for when part of the new creation implodes, taking all the so-called wicked, meaning not them, into the total implosion, annihilation forevermore. That's the ego's plan. That's how the ego sees it. So this new chapter sees through all of this, sees through the old chapter and the absurdity of it. But that type, you know, will try to get you to be that great failure for them, that sacrifice for them. So it's very dangerous. For anyone who has a frame of reference shift, it's a very dangerous situation in that regard. So we need the Holy Spirit advising us in this. You have people say, we're special. We have a special teacher, special sacrifice. That saved us. So when the bad part of the new creation implodes, which it must in order for the good part of the creation to be free of this feeling of failure, then we're not going to be implode. But the bad, those who don't accept, you know, aren't special, don't have this kinship, blood relationship, they're all going to be annihilated, cast into this fiery furnace forevermore, and incinerated into annihilation and stuff. See, that's the ego. That's the egoic plan. What else can the ego rationalize? This logic has to come up with something like this. How do I get rid of this feeling of failure? You know, the mind feels that it's failed to fixate. Well, that's the bad part of the mind. The good part of the mind must believe that it's trying to believe. So we think it's being held back from success by the bad part of the mind that's still got reservant doubts. Like, I don't feel like I fixated. In other words, the feeling part of the mind, I got doubts that I fixated it. That's the bad part. That part has to be annihilated. And then the good part of the mind says, you know, I really, really want to be able to fixate. I really believe I can. Well, that's the good part of the mind. And once the bad part's gone, that good part will then say, oh, yes, now I know that I can, and I did. Oh, whoopee, hallelujah. We all have this new creation now. That's, you know, totally the ego's plan, totally egoic. So we're not aiming to be gurus anymore, okay? We're aiming to be Dharma princes. I mean, use the non-gender specific terms. If we're using pronouns, we use the male, like Dharma prince, to cover non-gender specific concept here, or pointer here. And I've pointed that out in previous videos. Why? It's very, very important. Because the most reassuring aspect of the ego is the mother, feminine mother aspect. So we're most tempted to fall back into that. So at all costs, you have to avoid thinking that, you know, going back in, when you get really shocked, we can either do one of two things, the Holy Spirit way, which is wild practice, or the ego way, which is to go back to mother and say, oh, mother will figure out, mother will take care of me, mother will find a way to do the impossible. I feel so helpless. I feel I can't do anything. I'm in such shock. But, you know, when the child's in shock, what does the child cry for? Mother, right? And mother is totally egoic. That's the ego. That symbolizes fixation. The belief in this new creation where fixation, the mind can fixate itself. So you absolutely have to block that in every which way you can. You do not want to entertain the mother at all in any way in your psyche. So male pronouns help you avoid that. It's a practice, okay? It's not an ideology, it's a practice. It's wise practice. Now, I try to avoid pronouns for the most part altogether. So Dharma Prince it does have a male connotation to it. If there's some other way to refer to it, I can refer to it in that way. But in no way are we going to use female pronouns here in the new chapter. In no way, because hindsight has shown me, you know, how damaging that is actually. And part of the great implosion of our psychology is going back to all the female pronouns and the mother pronouns, which just greases the skids into egoic, believing in the ego. And it's cleverness, right? It's very, very clever, which is our own creativity turned to cleverness. And so we must pivot away from that, absolutely pivot away from it. It's extraordinarily injurious. Because again, our whole thing is to block panic, which means in order to get ready for the frame of reference shift, we have to keep putting ourselves in situations of shock, of shocking our expectations, of this is greatly beyond my expectations. And when we're in that state of shock, we have to avoid taking refuge in the ego. And the ego's great symbol of comfort and help is the mother, and by extension, the feminine. And so the ego is telling everyone in this world, don't worry, don't worry, don't worry. We'll take care of your shock from this implosion. You just turn to the feminine, turn toward the mother archetypes, turn that. That'll help, that'll take care of you. That's the ego. That's the ego. And of course, the ego is that it completes both the ego and the Holy Spirit. So it says, well, there's no problem. We can just combine the two. That is 100% ego. 100% ego. So keep that in mind. We're not combining the two here. I said avatar for none of my mind. Usually I just say avatar, so that helps us with that. So I should have said avatar, you know, the avatar. She always used male pronouns as well. Almost always. And some have tried to go back and change that. And every quote that she has when she uses he, they put he, she. Very bad. That's very egoic. Very troublesome, actually. There's a reason why she used that. There's a reason why the Dharma has always used male pronouns. At all costs, you have to avoid taking refuge in the mother, feminine mother. You must take refuge in the Dharma practice, which is this abstraction, one abstraction, which does not relate to any flesh, does not relate to any notion of fixation. The mother is the heart of our belief in fixation. Okay, so we absolutely cannot go there to be successful in this new way. Now, in the old way, you know, this is heresy, blasphemy, because the old way is egoic. And the ego is desperately trying to fixate the mind. You know, we're trying all attempts to get the mind to fixate itself, thinking that if we don't, we'll be annihilated. So it's of course playing hardball, very unfair. So it absolutely is trotting out the whole feminine mother goddess archetype stuff, trying to inundate us with this, to convince us to go through with this massive implosion. Psychological implosion and perhaps physical implosion, to, you know, shock the mind into remembrance of how to fixate, try to motivate the mind to do the impossible. And, you know, it's utterly futile, actually. See if I can start this phone now. Doesn't want to start. Huh. There you go. It's trying to start it up. So it did. So here, we're not trying to please the ego. In the new chapter, we're beyond trying to please the ego, and we have hindsight on it all. We're done with that. Now, for most people, that's just too frightening. They think the ego is the way to avoid annihilation. And we can also look at death as the ego's way of saying, well, before we reach the perfection of the new creation, we have to get used to partial annihilation. It's part of it. Part of us has to be annihilated. So there's always something that has to be annihilated. But we say ultimately, and that's getting rid of the bad stuff, so to speak. Gradually, you'll get the good stuff will rise, the cream will rise to the top, and then there'll be a final dispensation when the truly wicked are totally annihilated. And so death is helping us with this process, sort of a sorting out process sort of thing. That's also a way of looking at death as the ego throws everything again. It's trying everything, you know, it's trying everything. Of course, none of it works. It's mind trying to fixate the mind, which means fixating the mind means that one moment affects another moment. One moment inexorably exerts an influence upon the next moment. So you have process there. You have time there. So this moment now is dependent on a previous moment, the past, to be what it is now. Okay, that would be mental fixation. Whereas reality is that the mind, each moment is not influenced by the previous moment. It's complete fresh, creatively fresh, perfectly creatively fresh. And we're utterly free in bliss with no feeling of that we're being coerced by the past at all, past moments at all. And from this reality, it's just all love that we don't understand. We cannot struggle with trying to understand what this means, really. It requires a frame of reference shift. There's no way we can get it trying to imagine it at all. From the egoic standpoint. So we don't even call it love. We don't even call it bliss. We call it wow. We get off of the definitional treadmill. Okay. One definition for all definitions. This is practicing singularity. One insight settling it all. What's the insight? Wow is the insight. When we know how to block panic, then the frame of reference shift will take place automatically. We're ready for it. Once that takes place, there is no more regrets at all. We realize there's never been any. So that one key insight, what is that key insight? Wow, is the key insight. One insight settles it all. It's the refusal to play any definitional game at all, actually. But the realization that we have to block the panic of this, so temporarily accepting just one total abstract definition for everything, and holding, willing to do that. So that's an insight. And from this insight then arises the frame of reference shift, where we see how it really is, how reality really is. Experience it. But we keep the bridge up. We keep the bridge. So that we can feel free to retreat if we want. and we retreat into the wow. We say, okay, but I know what my retreat is going to be. It's going to be wow. My retreat is wow. My realization is wow. My retreat is wow. My realization is wow. My retreat is wow. My realization is wow. My retreat is wow. So flatten it out ahead of time. My realization is wow. My retreat is wow. My everything is wow. So when we're willing to commit to the singularity, that's the insight that settles it all. Because it gives rise to the frame of reference shift. So that's my experience last summer. So it's been not quite a year, maybe. I pivoted my attention and to this one key area in my mind, and then right away, all regrets vanished as if they'd never been. And then I said, wow. It's really true what Papa Sava said. It's really true. So since then, I've been really, really working every single day to let the attention settle on this one insight. And be committed to it. And so that's the new way. And throughout history, what have we said? The gurus will say, well, the genuine ones will say, you know, one pointedness of mind is the key. Once you reach that one pointedness of mind, the frame of reference shift will take place. Well, what is one pointedness of mind, really? I mean, that's I always struggle with, what are they saying there? And we need more clarification of that. Well, some used, you know, forceful concentration on just one item. Well, that's nice practice. What about the other items? Right. So it's a way. What they're saying is, yeah, you get to this commitment to just one structure, one definition. One. It doesn't really matter what it is they would say in the past. You get to the singularity, and you get used to it, the singularity. You commit to it. That's the absolute key to success. There's no question about it. So we know what that is now. We're really on, and we're practicing it. But we're not trying to forcefully concentrate our mind on it. We're just saying, wow is wow. Wow is wow and no wow is wow. Wow is wow and no wow is wow. So we're not trying to take an absolute position. Absolute is wow, non-absolute is wow. We're just practicing the singularity. We're not trying to fixate. The problem with trying to be overly forceful is you try to, as Buddha found out, you try to fixate a trance state. And that's still egoic. So we're saying wow is wow and no wow is wow. Freedom is wow and no freedom is wow. Success is wow and failure is wow. See, it doesn't feel fixated. We're trying to avoid that effort to fixate and make, you know, okay, I reached this one point in this, a super concentration, this very rajistic pathway like that, you know, fiery effort and all this. We would say, okay, one-pointedness is wow, and non-one-pointedness is wow. You know, we're not like, say, we got nirvana, we got it. We say nirvana as well, and samsara as well. As Longchenpa would say, samsara and nirvana are the same in intrinsic spaciousness. So what happened with Gautama Buddha was his attention finally pivoted to the one insight that settles it all. That's what happened. That's what took place. First, he was trying these other ways, which trying to please both the ego and the grace of God. And then he found problems with those. He says, I did it to the ultimate, and it didn't work. And he tried trance states, and then he tried asceticism, mortification of the flesh and all that. And neither one worked. And then he suddenly, when he was on the verge of despair, and defeat and failure, he suddenly recognized, oh, yeah, I forgot. Now it's brought to mind again. Suddenly, he recognized the one insight that settles it all. And then the frame of reference shift took place. You know, Buddha mind. And many, many, many have done that since. He just helped highlight it. The new chapter uses the great technique that's been used before, but we're it's super streamlined, and we're super focused on just that. Because we recognize how we kind of have been wandering a little in the past, trying to please both the ego and the Holy Spirit. Okay, and we have to say, okay, that's over with. We've spun a lot of egoicness around all these different traditions and new messages. Face. Mm-hmm. Just a little while here. Okay. Very great. But enough about the old chapter, right? We're in a new chapter, so let's just focus on that. We don't need to do too many retrospectives at this point, actually. We know what we're doing. So we're capping our expectations, our spiritual expectations. This was part of the key insight I had that led up to the success we're having now, is cap our expectations. Dharma Prince, novice in the new way. Novice in the new way. Because those very deep expectations play out in the afterlife, you might say. They're so deep that it's not wise to proclaim ultimate success here unless you truly are a Dharma King. Longchenpa did proclaim it. Buddha did proclaim it. The Dharma kings are able to. Ramana proclaimed it. Okay. But they don't advise us to do that. So if they advise us not to do that, then we don't do it. So charismatic guru-ness proclaiming ultimate success here is off our plate. We've capped our expectations. We're not going there. And this takes an enormous burden off of us, because if we expect to go there, what will happen is we'll try to please both the ego and the Holy Spirit. I mean, try to please our deep expectations of failure and our new expectations of success, our absence of failure. And that'll cause the old patterns to continue. So we're not going to do that. And the non-dual that has come from Rama Maharshi, and the stuff is coming, has done a pretty good job of that, really. I mean, they've been very humble, a lot of them. Very careful about that in some ways. They laid very low. Maybe even, you know, at this point, even too low. I don't know. We'll see. Or perhaps they're playing it just the right way. So we can have the frame of reference shift such that we really feel, get comfortable with it here in this world. But we have to let that generalize, continue to generalize through the very, very deeply held expectations, so ancient, such that it we actually get comfortable with this new frame of reference as it applies to all the entire wheel of transmigration, what we might call the afterlife and other realms. Excuse me. We have to allow that to truly generalize and become comfortable with that. That may take a while, you know, longer than how long we might stay here in this world. You could tell that Rama Maharshi had that all, that was done. Okay, you could tell. Sri Sri Anand Maya, you could tell. That was all done, no doubt about it. For them, there was no place at all. There was only everywhere, you know, you could tell. So there's this difference. Look, for them, you could feel there was some difference compared to other gurus. Who had still not, you know, still the deep expectations of failure were still reverberating there to some extent, right? And the ones who maintained this humility then functioned here as very helpful spiritually for us, very helpful. They were turning the wheel of Dharma for us. And the ones who claimed, you know, ultimacy, when they didn't have it, ended up trying to put the brakes on the wheel of Dharma, actually. Saying, no, there is a way to fixate the mind. We discovered it. Our sacrifice will make it possible. Just trust in us and give us all this specialness, you know. So, wow. The frame of reference shift is wow. The grace of God is already shining upon me. As promised, and it's greater than expected. Wow, 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 wow. The new way is to pay attention to how this new way is unfolding. That's part of it. So a lot of it is still, they're very much into the old chapter. And we're very much into the new chapter here. This is why I got pushed off of Facebook. And may or may not go back, I don't know. You know, it may be way too dangerous a thing to do. They're trying to make the old chapter work somehow, when in fact, the old chapter was set up in such a way destined to implosion. It's so egoic. There's still tremendous expectations of failure in the old chapter. Tremendous. So really, I would say the Dharma, one of its main goals was to get us into this new chapter. So that represents the success of the old chapter is best represented by those of us who have gotten into the new chapter. where we have much, much diminished expectations of failure. Highly diminished expectations of failure. I know I have highly diminished expectations of failure. But I know there are still some expectations of failure, absolutely. Which is why I'm not allowed to go back to that golf course I used to go to. Because that was building in expectations of failure in me, very severely. And I realized I'm not good enough to overcome that at this point. You see, that's humility we're talking about. I can see how it's possible, but I'm not good enough at this point. At some point, ultimately, I'll be able to overcome the expectations of failure there. I'll have the shots. But I don't have them yet. It's just theoretical in my mind. Okay? So I'm not going to go back there and feel like I can big time that golf course, because it's not going to work. And the old patterns will reassert themselves. So we really want to get off the old patterns and not even give them a chance to get a hold of us. So we want to go to a much wider open situation where the setup is not conducive at all to failure, to feeling the failure. So in other words, an easier golf course, a wide open golf course. It doesn't have to be super easy, but it can still be challenging. But it can induce us to be more confident, grab the driver, get used to smashing it, and regain that sense of like, hey, I'm a success out here. I'm really successful. Failure doesn't happen to be. That's really important to feel that way. So I was banned to go back to that place. Really banned, spiritually banned from it. And it's a beautiful place, but it's a treacherous place. The beauty hides the treachery of the course, actually. It's designed to make you feel to expect failure. It really is. And I only saw, again, one person overcome that to some extent. Even he was kind of like, ah, this, of course, you know, it's tough. I mean, come on. But he was so good that he was able to cut through that. So you have to be extremely good to cut through it. I'm not that good. To proclaim yourself a Dharma king in this world, you have to literally have truly have not the slightest expectation of failure whatsoever and no tendency at all to go back to that. Nothing can tempt you to go back to it. No situation can possibly tempt you to go back to it. That's a Dharma king. I believe Jamyang Khenchi Choki Lodra was working on the final steps to being a Dharma king while here. You see, the final steps, that's why I call him a Dharma king. Maybe one of the newest ones. His utter humility here, but super incisive action. You know, he was never tempted away from his utter humility here. And yet everybody looking up to him like, you're the greatest. But keeping a super low profile is quite astonishing. So I believe that he was going through the final, you know, stages of that of being truly a Dharma king, and there are others who proclaim themselves as such when they were here. They had already, you know, gone through it. And like a Ram Maharshi, he'd already gone through all of that and could say, you know, yeah, I'm definitely it. Anandamayi could say that. I'm Purna Brahma Narayana. She didn't want to. She had to be like almost, you know, severely pressured, but she would say, okay, you know, if you really want to know what I'm, you know, I'm the perfect appearance of the Absolute. Meaning no temptation whatsoever to imagine there could be any absence of perfection. No temptation whatsoever. Now those are avatars and Dharma kings. But we're not that, okay? And we won't be that in this lifetime, okay? We won't be that. I don't feel I'm in the final stages like Jamyang Khenchi Choki Lodron, no. I feel I'm on the road, okay, and am doing, you know, the right significant progress that needs to be done on that road. But there will be work to do down the road as well. So the whole Dharma King thing is a very distant sort of thing, so distant that I don't really focus on it, don't really think about it. You know, lots of expectations of failure still to let go of. But we can let go of a very significant amount of them at this point. Very significant. So much so significant we can be extremely helpful to those who are, you know, still working towards that frame of all important frame of reference shift. All important. And we can get to the point where we feel that, well, this is it. But we do not want to assert, you know, that I'm going to be this way forevermore. So what we do is say, well, I'm going to be this for now. I see it this way. But later on, who knows? Later on is wow. I'm not making a commitment for, quote unquote, the future. Who knows? Later on, I might go back to believing in failure. All right? Possible, right? So, but for now, I'm not experiencing any failure. But I could always go back to it if I wanted to, sure. That could happen, but not right now. So now is wow, the future is wow. We leave it in this indeterminate, ultimately indeterminate state for now, which allows the resonance of, well, there's no failure now, to be felt without making the absolute commitment statement that for sure, this is forevermore, I'll never be tempted again. So we don't go there. We don't go there. We keep practicing, in other words. We keep practicing, even though our presence may become very helpful. We keep practicing. This is the Tibetan Buddhist way. Many have had a frame of reference shift, and yet they still remain very humble and kept practicing. So we very much advocate this in the new way. We're taking the best of the old way here, right? Yeah, I mean, you have these lamas, these rinpoches, these, you know, these ones who have had the frame of reference shift and were abiding in it, quite successfully. They're still very humble, and still practicing, and encouraging everyone to practice. They're still practicing, and setting the example for everyone else like that. You know, that's what's required. That's what's really helpful. That's what's truly helpful. That's how they're able to keep turning the wheel of Dharma so successfully, is this humility of the ones who have succeeded in a frame of reference shift, understanding the deep expectations that they don't want to claim, you know, ultimate victory. They say, you know, hey, yeah, I've got the frame of reference shift. I'm abiding in it right now, but later on, who knows? Down the road, who knows? I'm not going to count those chickens before they're hatched at all. So I'm going to keep practicing, actually. I still have some deep expectations that I, at least the echoes of them, at least the temptation is still there. Maybe all failure disappeared, but what about the temptation, you see? What about that? What about the old habits, turning back to them? We could always do that, right? There's nothing preventing us from hallucinating again. So we could do it. Even though we see that I'm totally free, you know, are we really free of the temptation to hallucinate again? We don't want to absolutely state that. I'm just wow, is what I am. I'm just wow. I'm wow now, and the future, well, the future is wow as well. But we don't really say what wow is, do we? We don't really say, it's just wow. What is that? It's wow. So we maintain this indeterminate stance, which enables us to abide right now and give benefit to help turn the wheel of Dharma, like that. For the benefit of all beings who are still desperately trying to fixate the mind and trying to reshape their expectations so they don't expect failure in letting go of this impossibility. Since it's impossible, we have to let go of it. So we have to experience success in letting go of it. And we're so conditioned, our expectations, to failing to achieve the impossible, that this becomes this tremendous barrier. Even when we succeed, we go back to failure. You know, we succeed in letting go of the impossible, and then we go back. So, oh, I'm not used to that feeling of success. There's no failure. Where's failure? Oh my gosh, I need failure. Where's that ocean of failure? Oh, I'm back to it. Okay, great. At least I got back to what I'm familiar with. This is the great adversary. It's the great adversary. The ego, per se, is not really our adversary. It's our expectations. Our expectations are the great adversary, and they've already been conditioned for us. So we've conditioned them. So nobody is immune to that. You know, everybody has to go through this. It takes the patience, it takes the humility to go through it. So we want to set the example of patience and humility. It's humiliating to flounder. I've been floundering for 50 years. I mean, if you count the age of 12, 1968, if you count that year as one, I'm about ready to go into my 50th year. Or is that even complete 50 years? So 12 would be the completion of year 1, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23, 24, 25, 26, 27, 28, 29, 30, 31, 32, 33, 34, 35, 36, 37, 38, 39, 40, 41, 42, 43, 44, 45, 46, 47, 48, 49, 50, 51, 52, 53, 45, 56, 57, 89, 60. Okay, so I will have completed 49 years when I hit my birthday this summer. So I will be soon, I will be starting, very soon, I will be starting my 50th year of working on this, 50th year. So, you know, very humiliating, right? Nobody wants to say that. Everybody wants to say, well, I did it, you know, quickly. I didn't have much failure in my expectations. Oh, no. Better think again. So the humility to keep working at it, in spite of it taking a long time, is really very tough. Because basically you're admitting that you have so much expectations of failure. And then you think, well, the world looks at me like a failure. I got so much expectations of failure. But really, you're digging deep and finding the deeper, deeper, deeper expectations. I say, my gosh, it runs really deep, doesn't it? Whereas most just see the superficial and try to fix it there and say, I got rid of the superficial ones. Whee, I'm free, I'm enlightened. It doesn't last. You go into the charismatic thing. You make a deal with the devotees. I'll appear to be free for a while if later on I appear to be a failure. And then they say, okay, that's good enough. That'll make us look good, you know, make us seem special. We don't have any failure. When the bad part of hallucination disappears, we'll have the good part, you know, and all the rest will go. They're driven by fear. They're too driven by fear. That's still the ego, very much the ego. So, yeah, 49 years under my belt already. So only the Dharma kings, you know, can really understand the humility, how I feel, right? They've been through it. The rest of the world probably looks at me like, ah, I don't want to listen to him. It took too long. I don't want to take that long. But keep in mind, we're smoothing everything out. We're getting to how to actually abide, you know. And we're pioneering a new chapter. So a lot of effort had to go into this. And realistically, you know, most will need to practice their whole life. It's not going to be, I'm done with practicing. And again, I said, even if the frame of reference shift occurs, we still practice. Because the temptation is still there. The echoes, so to speak, the echoes of familiarity are still there. And so we continue to practice. So just realize you'll be practicing for a lifetime. which is a fabulous thing, but you will be super helpful. You see, you will really be setting the right example for so many. That's easy for me to say in this modern era, but that's what the Tibetans did. I mean, they were just enculturated, and if you take the spiritual path, you're on it for your life, whole lifetime, and maybe many lifetimes. There's no question, ands, ifs, or buts about it at all. You don't become a monk and take the monastic vows, or a lay monk and get help from the lamas and all this, and you've committed, and just to do it for a little while. And then say, okay, I got it. You know, I'm finished with that. I got it. And now I can do other stuff or whatever. That was never the expectations of that culture. And it shouldn't be our expectations either. Now, it's easier for those who are older to say this. That's why, one of the reasons they revere the elders so much, because the elders, let's face it, don't have that much more practicing to go. I mean, what do I have, maybe 35 more years or whatever, however long I stick around, however long Longchampa blocks my death, of practicing, you know, still practicing. Yeah, but if you're young, you think, oh my gosh, you know, I have like 80 years more of this, like, you know, oh, it's too much. So it's hard for the young to set the example. But the elders who have done it, you know, that gets the nod, you know. It's easy to say you're going to do it, but the ones who have actually done it, that's where the true respect goes to. Any youngster can say, oh yeah, I'm going to do it. Fine, okay, that's great. That's a much appreciated attitude. But at the same time, let's make sure we recognize the ones that have done it to keep encouraging us before we realize it is possible. It is possible, it is doable, and look at the results, great results. So that's what the Tibetan Buddhists had going for them. As they were dispersed, that certainly was a great blow to it all, to say the least. A great implosion of it. But it's the age of implosion, and maybe they were showing us that indeed it is the age of implosion, and you better really pay attention to the Dharma right now. So they allowed that to happen, so they could help spread this Dharma, to help us get through this terrible age of implosion and get into the new chapter. So it was an act of compassion on their part to even allow it to happen in the first place. Nothing happens unless we script it and allow it to happen. So they had to have allowed that to happen, the invasion of Tibet, the occupation of Tibet. They had to allow it to happen. And it may have been that they saw it was beneficial for all beings, that we needed this boost at this time to get us through. And they certainly did give us the boost. Without that happening, we wouldn't have had this massive boost from Tibetan Buddhism. It would not have. They were very isolated from the rest of the world, extremely so. And they wanted to remain so. It's very helpful for them. And so this brought them out of isolation. It brought the world's attention to them. And in doing so, many, many of us became aware of just how amazing their Dharmic culture was. And it really fired. It was so intriguing. It was really like, you might say that was like the most intriguing storyline. If that happened, in, was it 1959? Something like that. So I was 3 years old then, and that was an extremely intriguing storyline for those who were dharmically. And so I've always had that storyline in my life about Tibet. So much intrigue, like what is in Tibet? I was so intrigued by it. And I said, oh, we're getting some stuff trickling out now, trickling information. So I was reading this. And the hidden land of these, you know, these great spiritual depths and mysteries, it had such an intrigue for me, such a pull for me. So that became a lifelong storyline, lifelong movie that I've been able to watch. So certainly I'm willing to pay them back, and whichever way, help them whichever way I can. because they've been just astonishingly helpful for the world, that their choice to allow all this information to go out to everyone, knowing that most of us, you know, the world's not really ready for it and we might misconstrue it and all this, but that it would find those who it could benefit. And so it's just a stupendous helpfulness there. Again, without that, I couldn't have made it. No way. Couldn't be here where I'm at, still working on making it, so to speak. You know, being part of the solution, part of the unfoldment of this new way, this new chapter. Would not be here. No way, no way. So all of that has taken root long ago, you see. I don't have to have it take root now. It happened long ago in the previous chapter. And now I'm experiencing the fruits of it. And the fruits of it really are this new way. Be able to go into this new chapter. A super fruit. And this bird of paradise coming to nest on my head, roost on my head. It's very wowish. And so for me, I don't put it into any context other than wow. I mean, you could put it into millions of spiritual contexts, couldn't you? I mean, you could go run riot. I don't allow my mind to go there. I say it's simply wow. And the unfoldment will be wow. And it's the new way is wow. The new way is wow. The bird roosting on my head is wow. And again, the new way is what? One insight settles it all. Frame of reference shift. Abidance in the frame of reference shift. That's what it's about. That's what it's all about. The other stuff, been there and done that. So we're really streamlining it into tremendous simplicity here. And this is not the old stuff of trying to please the ego and the Holy Spirit too anymore. It's not. We'll honor our creative efforts by through the wow and not getting ahead of ourselves, but we're not going to please the ego by following its orders, you know? No. We will honor our creativity through the wow. We're doing that. We still keep a definition. Wow. We still leave the future open. Who knows? We're not going to say it's absolutely done. We're going to say it's wow. That's honoring our creativity. We really have to do that. We've been, you know, used all our creativity to try and deceive ourselves, right? And so, you know, don't underestimate our creativity and the extent of our expectations. We've had massive amount of failure for so long, and we keep trying and trying and trying because we feel no for sure we're going to be able to do it, because we think our creativity can't be beat. Well, there's one thing our creativity can't do, which is change reality. That's it. And Jesus pointed this out tirelessly in Course in Miracles Dialogue on Awakening and Journey Beyond Words. Tirelessly points this out. There's one thing we cannot do, our creativity cannot do, it cannot change reality. And that's what we've been trying to do. So, again, massive, massive expectations have already there. We honor that by not counting our chickens until they're hatched, really. We're not going to make an absolute statement that we're never going to fall again, okay? We're not going to say that. So we cannot claim Dharma kinghoodness. We cannot claim that. We're not going to claim that. We'll claim, if we do have the frame of reference ship, we'll claim and abide in it. That's Dharma princeness, okay? We can assert that. But that's it. Dharma prince is not finished, okay? It's not totally confirmed. They're just helping turn the wheel of Dharma. They're able to help turn the wheel of Dharma. And our future is wow. Frame of reference shift, wow. So what we do, we cap our expectations, and that enables us to have the frame of reference shift and to abide in it. Very powerful help. Not everyone's willing to do that. Especially those who still, you know, trying to please the ego. The temptation, it may still get them. I don't know. Hopefully not. Hopefully not. Hopefully our work we do here will help those who are still tempted by that. It's a very severe temptation. The ego says, look, you claim, you know, that you're totally finalized and finished, and you claim ultimate status, and we'll make sure the mother will help you out, the goddess will help you out to give you, convince everyone of that, and then when you fail, she'll take care of all that failure too. She'll make sure it's not too bad and everything. You know, so you go behind that is always the mother archetype. I found that to be true. I found everyone who's still trying to do it the egoic way, you scratch beneath the surface, and the belief that mother can take care of whatever failure happens. Don't worry about it. She'll take care of it all. She'll take care of the panic, the shock. She'll deal with all of that. You don't have to practice anymore. Claim ultimacy right now. You don't have to practice anymore. She'll take care of all that. It's always there. It's always there. So it's taboo. It's taboo to go there in the new way. That's why Nana My Ma said, don't call me mother. We used her recognized name. We could just say Sri Sri Nanda Mai Me, Nanda Mai, Nanda Mai Me, Nanda Mai Ma, Queen of Wow, Miss Heaven, you know. Maybe other terms will come as we go along. But she pleaded with everyone, don't see me as mother. She said, that will be detrimental to you. So she knew absolutely what the trouble was. But they said, no, 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 no. We know that, you know, you, with you, we can be finally finished right now, and we can rely upon you. And she said, no, 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 you got to rely on your practice. So don't view me as mother. View me as someone who can truly encourage you to rely on your effective practicing, and don't rely on a mother archetype to clean up the mess that you're going to cause if you claim, you know, claim too much for yourself. Or to... You, the glamour of the mother goddess to convince everybody that you are it, you know. They use that heavily. This is don't use me that way. So she is not a mother goddess. I always experience her as like a little sister, usually that way. Who absolutely avoids any connotation of a mother goddess. Absolutely avoids it. No, not a trace of spiritual ego whatsoever. So she's helping us out with this to a tremendous extent. I've had a tremendous number of experiences with her help. Almost every day now. The one last night with the aging just disappearing, you know. That's it. There she goes again. So it's hard for someone to see it, their little sister as a mother archetype. Because they were born before her, right, as far as families go. Sometimes we can see an older sister. Sometimes the older sister raises the children, and they can look up to the older sister as a goddess archetype, mother archetype. But if she's your little sister, that's extremely difficult to see it that way, isn't it? So that's why she said, see me as your little sister, younger than you, younger than you. So you are not tempted to see me as a mother archetype. That's why she said that. or a friend. You don't are not tempted to see a friend as a mother archetype. Hardly, right? Hardly. You're equals. How could you see mother archetype is someone vastly greater than you? When you go into that infant mother archetype thing, mother, you're seeing someone who's vastly more capable than you. You feel helpless and incapable to deal with stuff, but the mother knows exactly how to deal with all this and will take care of all of it without you having to do anything at all. No practice involved. Whereas a friend's not like that. A friend is saying, hey, you know, come on, you carry your load too here. We both are carrying a heavy load here. They kind of needle you and beak you a bit and make sure that you know, keep up and you walk together side by side like that. That's like golfers. They're like that. Like, hey, we're all friends out here. Nobody can hit the golf ball for you. Come on. And if you hit it by like the ladies' tee or something, which I did pretty much so one hole, I topped the shot. I came up over it and topped it and just like dribbled up for a little into some waste area. I was like, I didn't say like, oh, could you, Mom, go hit that for me? Could you get, you know, I'm in a terrible spot now. No. I said, oh, okay, I still see the ball. Okay, it's hittable, playable, great. So then I went and tried to hit it. I used the wrong club. It was buried in all these weeds and stuff, and it plopped into a soggy, boggy trough in front. Lost ball. And the guy said, I said, should I drop back? He said, no, go drop in front of it. You know, go drop. I said, okay. You know, that's a friend. I said, yeah, okay, we'll let you off the hook here. We know you're struggling a bit here. Go drop in front of the soggy, boggy trough. Weeds and everything. And hit from there. So I dropped, not in a nice place, but and made a good shot from there. And I didn't, you know, they don't let you feel sorry for yourself. Hey, we can't hit the ball for you. What do you do? Get Mom to hit it for you here? But ladies, Steve, come on. They're like that. And so you realize when you play golf, you know, you got to finish 18 holes. You got to hit the golf ball. Nobody's going to do it for you. So it's very helpful in that way. It's like, wow. And it's tough. We don't want to go out there sometimes. Like, my gosh, you know, I know I'm going to get in some trouble and who knows what, but nobody's going to help me. Wow. And you can tell when the guys are getting in trouble, it's getting to them. What do? They start talking about women or something out there. They're really thinking about Mom. It's just, I wish Mom was out here and she could take care of me. I'm really feeling like a baby out here. Right, you do. You feel like a helpless baby sometimes. Yeah, they basically crying, Mommy, I'm struggling, Bob, I'm struggling. And then, you know, they expect Mom to come rushing in. Oh, what's wrong? What's wrong? Okay, let me fix this for you, fix this for you, fix this for you. Don't give up on fixation. You know, we can do it. We can do it. I'm struggling with this fixation thing. Oh, no. Don't worry. Don't worry. We got it all. This world will help you out with it. Don't worry. It's fine. It's a nice world. It'll help you out with fixation. It'll help you, and you'll be able to succeed at that. And I have confidence in you. You can do it. I'll help you do it. Don't worry. Don't worry. Don't worry. And the child says, okay, but it seems so difficult. She goes, oh, you'll get used to it. Don't worry. Okay, Mom. Like that. So Mom is the confident voice of the ego. A very confident, soothing voice of the ego, saying, don't worry, we'll get it done. You won't be one of the ones that get annihilated. Don't worry, we're special. You have a special birth. I think you're special. Really? So I'm not in danger? No, but you got to stay special, and we'll help you with that. But if you just really stay special in my eyes, there's no way you're going to be annihilated when the wicked ones are annihilated. No way. See, so it's so tempting to go there. It is so tempting to go there. So we're not going to claim at some point in the future that we might not go there. Even though we're abiding in absence of any failure, we're not going to make that claim because that is really tempting, right? We could decide to get pulled back into that. Don't worry. you won't be one of the ones that gets annihilated. The ego has to have this duality of like, some will succeed, there'll be some success, some will succeed perfectly, the others annihilated. And that's some way to split off the impossibility of this situation into total failure, which frees the others up for total success. You see, that's how it's done. That's very dualistic. And so we have to have some way to believe in this specialness. And of course, mom is ultimately the one who tries to tell the baby, the children, that to me, you know, you're special. You can never fail. In my eyes, you're certainly going to succeed here at your mission. You will certainly succeed. That's mother confidence. But the Holy Spirit's confidence is totally different. Now, when you follow the mother confidence, you end up with mental chaos and hoping that that's success. And it isn't. And then you say, my gosh, even mom can't help me. I got no one, nowhere to turn. And then you find out there's a Holy Spirit. And that's the one that has true confidence, who knows the right practices to practice, how to practice properly. Even Ananda Maimai tells me, stay away from me, stay away from me, stay away. Don't do that, don't do that, don't do that, stay away from me. You'd be tempted back to go back to the mother complex, that you're special, that you can succeed that way. Trust in your practice. That's what will succeed. Of course, most of her pictures showcase her as a mother archetype. There's very few pictures of her when she's young. So she says, what I really am is, when I come to you in dreams, I'm that young, your little sister. Just look at me that way. You know, don't look at those pictures, keep pulling you back into thinking that that I'm the mother and that the mother can fix the situation for you. No. She can motivate you to keep practicing is what she can do. See, that's the real help. That's the dharmic help. Motivate you to keep practicing that there's no specialness at all. A new way practice. I have no specialness. I'm nothing. I have no value at all. I've never had value. I never will have value. There's no possibility I can ever have even the slightest value no matter what I do. I'm completely hopeless. There's no hope for me whatsoever. See, no mother would allow you to practice this way. If a mother heard you practice this way, she would bring you into a psychiatrist, or she would like punish you severely. She says, no child of mine should ever think that they're thick this way. You do have hope. You are special. You know, they give you this severe pep talk, and if you continued in it, they would think that you're mentally deranged. For sure. What mother would allow this kind of practice? Well, Ananda Maimai absolutely supports this practice. That shows you she is not a mother archetype at all. She's a true Dharma king. He says, yeah, you got no hope. I have no hope whatsoever. I have no hope whatsoever. Exactly right. Of course, what I truly am doesn't need any hope. Right? So we have to accept that fact, that a total absence of failure, without any trace of failure ever being present in the first place. That's the reference, frame of reference shift shows us something along those, you know, like that. We understand, you know, hey, it shows us, wow. But we have to keep realizing it's very profound. So, again, the mother will not allow this kind of practice. I don't go to my mom and say, this is what I'm practicing, isn't this great? She'll think I'm, you know, absolutely insane. And so will your mother, okay? I don't advise you to say, Mom, you know, this is where it's at. They're the last ones who will go along with that. Their dying day, they won't go along with that, because it makes them feel special that they're telling you that you're special, you see? That's how they get their sense of feeling special. So we say, I have no hope whatsoever. I'm totally devoid of any hope. I have zero hope. I've always had zero hope, and I always will have zero hope. I have no capabilities whatsoever. Okay? Never have had any, never will have any. I can never come up with any answers. I've never been able to, never can, never will. Incapable of coming up with any answers. I can't solve anything. I'm incapable of solving anything whatsoever. Completely incompetent. I am completely incompetent. Have always been completely incompetent. And of course, your mother say, "What are you talking about? I taught you this. I taught you this. I taught you this." You know, so they don't get it. Okay, they won't get it. Don't try. Don't try to tell them that this practice. I'm totally incompetent. I've always been totally incompetent. Wow. Always will be totally incompetent. Wow. Now we're putting the time in, because we're starting this new chapter, this new way. So if you want like a start a business, guess what? You're gonna be working night and day. You're gonna be working around the clock almost. Like the entrepreneurs of, maybe the reason I'm in Silicon Valley is the entrepreneurial spirit here. You know that everyone feels this. Like, you know, you're a workaholic. These people are workaholics, because you know $1 billion is beckoning them, and they feel that they can do it. So they, you know, eat and sleep in their offices around the clock for years and years and years and years. So maybe that's helpful for me to have that feeling, like, you know, you're starting a new, helping start a new way, a new chapter. You know, I'm eating and sleeping it too, you know, constantly on it. And that's what entrepreneurial startup requires. It requires someone who's really, really committed to it, who really believes in success. So much so that they say, "Look, I'm willing to really slave away at this because I know it's going to be successful." So you may say, "Well, I can't watch 3-hour videos." Okay, you go, "You can't put 3 hours into a startup? I mean, then how can you expect the stock in a startup? You can't even put 3 hours into it today." I guarantee you that those who are working on startups today, Sunday, they're putting all day Sunday, they're working on it. They don't have time for families, relationships, or anything. It's their work is everything. So they're working on Sunday round the clock. And the ones who do that also, along with them, they get it. You know, they get it. They end up getting stock in the company. They get up, you know, they get the rewards, the fruit down the road. Because they believed enough to really, really put in the long hours. So putting in long hours here is a way of life here for those who really want to be successful. So that's probably been very, very helpful for me. Otherwise, yeah, you know, maybe not have done it, right? Because there's no cultural support for that type of workaholicism. But a lot of these tech people, they're not very fun people. They live it entirely. They're just absolutely focused on what they're doing. That's all they do. They don't allow themselves even a bottle of wine. So once we get the, you know, the funding and it's all going great, at some point maybe we'll crack open a bottle of wine and have a celebration, but we're not celebrating until then. They're very driven that way. Very disciplined. And they may say, once we get listed on the stock exchange, that then we'll celebrate, but not until then. So a lot of deferred gratification. A lot of deferred gratification. And you can do that when you're young, but when you're this age, it's much, much more difficult, isn't it? So I'm still deferring all gratification, really. Still right on the edge of destitution. But still, you know, working frantically at it. Whereas those guys, you know, they want to have it made by the time they're, you know, 30. Retire at 35. A lot of them do. Ones that make it, they're set. You know, they feel they're retired. A lot of their goals to retire by like 35, and they think that's a career. You know, they worked really hard. I worked really hard to get to 35 in retirement. Are you kidding me? Well, that's not, you know, they don't have the stomach for the Dharma. Then, you know, try working in that all out entrepreneurial effort for 50 straight years without, you know, And only now starting to get, you know, hey, the bird of paradise comes and rests on my head. Okay. So again, I say the bird of paradise on my head. Wow, the bird of paradise not on my head. Wow. I'm not saying it's going to remain. I'm not going to say that. You know, maybe I would at some point ask it to leave. I'm not saying one way or the other. I'm just saying, wow, the situation is just wow. That's all. Bird of paradise on my head, situation, wow. It's neither certain nor uncertain. It's neither certain nor uncertain. It's wow. Which keeps us humble, right? Neither certain nor uncertain. It's wow. It's neither certain it'll stay. It's staying is neither certain nor is it uncertain. It's just wow. We're not certain it will stay, we're not certain it will leave, and we're not certain that there's a uncertainty about any of this. It's just wow. So we're neither certain nor uncertain, right? We cannot have an absolute, say, well, I'm absolutely uncertain. We're not stating that either. So it's this wonderful abstraction where it leaves the door open for the absolute. It leaves it open. We're not certain that it's uncertain either. We're wow in both always about this. Always about this. So you cannot describe the wow as certain, nor can you describe it as uncertain. It's just wow. Wow is wow. Time is it? 1:19. I'm still in the wilds here, so you know, just don't rush it, don't force anything. Haven't eaten yet today, that's okay. My weight is as we cool down a little bit here, my weight is close to my maximum allowable. So I'm trying to Monday I wanna see the scale, give me something that I say, okay, good, good. I'm still, you know, in the game there. It almost got away from me. It almost got away from me. Beginning of summer, July 4th, it almost got away, but it hasn't got away. I still have to be really, really disciplined today, and through the next week, if I can. But let me take it a day at a time here. Just today, I'm gonna be disciplined. Because I'm aiming for some, you know, some situation, whatever arises, of maybe catching my breath a little bit here. I said I'll help this usher in the new way if you give me some breaks, you know, along the way, where I kind of catch my breath and float in a pool or something and just, wow, yeah, just take it easy for a little bit, as much as I can do that, but... So I've really been gunning the engine here for about 45 days, you would say. Yeah, 45 days. 44, you might, maybe 44, 45 days. I've been really gunning the engine all out. So I may need to get a little break from this. Actually, absolutely. So it's like a new chapter in how we perceive ourselves, and put, you know, 44. I committed to do it, to start it. I've done 44 days now of a full on commitment to it, and it's been very stressful to say the least. And I just need to get my weight down a little bit, get my golf game a little bit tweaked, if I can do that. And hopefully something will arise. I don't see anything on the horizon at this point, but that doesn't mean it won't come out of the blue. I kind of need to, you know, well, we'll see what happens. I mean, I got to prepare for it. I prepare for it. Now, I don't know if that bird was telling me to get a haircut or what. Maybe. I don't know. Possible. Get my hair cut short. Get ready for the rest of the summer. There's still, you know, July, and really 3 months of summer still left, pretty much so. September's still very warm. So there's really still 3 months of summer left. And we want to really be very much down the road with this new way by November of this year. November is always a pivotal month, very pivotal. What you do in November absolutely sets the tone for the next year. You cannot wait for December to set the tone because of the Christmas holidays and the lack of light and everything. You really have to be committed to the next year by the end of November. So November is this really this month of getting committed. Really, you're fired up and committed. It's hard to pioneer anything in November. November is say, okay, you know, let's settle on something here. So we can power through December and then into the new year with this really fresh, great, optimistic outlook, which is what I did, was able to do last year. Had an intensive starting November. We powered through that. Power through December into the new year with all this okay commitment. This is the year we're going to start a new chapter. We're doing it. So we've got like 3 months still. So this is the 9th. So the 9th of August is 9th of September, 9th of October. So there's 3 months of summer left. And October is always when I get the greatest boost. So that then sets up November to be this commitment. So 3 more months of whatever, of the summer of 17. Then what? 1 month of probably tremendous fruits, and then another month of commitment to great, you know, wowness in 2018. Yeah, and then, you know, go from there. Roaring into 218. So there it is. There it is. So we have 3 months of summer, then one of a big boost, one of getting the commitment, and then 1 month of powering through the end of the year, Christmas holidays, New Year, powering through that. So there's like four phases left here for this year. But rather feeling the heat, starting to heat up today too, but feeling the intensity of it is just, you know, it's everything that I can take actually. Letting my body recover. I should start drinking some, I need to start drinking some recovery drinks today. I'll do that. I gotta get into that. The strawberries, the blueberries, the protein drink, the L-glutamine, the whey protein, and really get hydrated with that. And so the body's recovering from all that intense swing work pretty nicely. The soreness is starting it to leave. So I feel like I got through it barely. I want to be more careful in the future. That's for sure. Not overdo it so much. I just realized that new golf shaft is coming through my 3-wood, 3-metal, extra stiff. I can take the shaft out of my 3-metal and put it in my 2-hybrid. Why not? It'll be just a little oversized as far as the length goes. And you want a little kick if you're using it off the fairway anyway. So, but that will actually probably help the 2-wood go further. Wow, that's amazing. Because I was trying to order a new shaft for the 2-wood, an extra stiff. I couldn't find one that I was happy with. No, I could not. So this way, I can do it this way. Wow, that's fantastic. That's tremendous. Wow. Huge problem solved there, I believe. Yeah. That's very exciting, very intriguing. So along with this intrigue is a lot of hard work, right? A lot of work here, a lot of reshaping your expectations. Keep in mind, the eons and eons we've been trying to fixate the mind, and the failure, that it's all been failure. So our expectations are so accustomed to failure that we keep failing to this frame of referenceship. We get a glimpse of it, and then we fail. Glimpse of it, we fail. That's the same way for everyone. Okay, so if you're getting glimpses, you're doing great. And now, but we're really focused on how to make those, how those glimpses can be actual abidance. So it's hard work. It's hard work. But the payoff is what you want. It's what you want, ultimately, right? So yeah, it's very intriguing what's happening with me, my death being blocked, bird of paradise coming to now nest on my head. Very intriguing. And I may get a haircut, actually. Maybe he was telling me, get a haircut. And so all of this is very intriguing. But also a lot of work here. A lot of stress. Yeah, startups are stressful. Okay, very great. I'm gonna proceed now in a wonderful way, in a wowish way. So the new way is wow. The new way is wow. The new way is wow.